on this nanotechnology of fiction. Have you heard of nanotechnology? How many of you? What have you heard of? What do you know about nanotechnology? Small, yeah. It is really, really small. How many of you listened to the lecture by Dr. Ranathunga? How many of you? Okay, so you were listening to something very, very big and far away so far. So I'll take you to a very tiny world, which is the opposite of what he did. Okay? So, to start with, do you know who this is?
Spider-Man.
How many of you wanted to be a Spider-Man when you were small? Yes? Okay. So,
materials which can do the job.
So after my lecture, I will ask the question, what material you will select for the purpose. So this was a fiction. By 20th century or 21st century, this fiction was coming into truth. So why I selected this? Now, every science evolved as a fiction. So it started, people were dreaming, people were imagining. As the Nalaka said, imagination is more important than knowledge. People were dreaming of things. In early 1895, people were dreaming of sending an aircraft or making an aeroplane, an object which can fly. So it was a dream at the beginning. Many scientists around the world were working on making such a machine. But some scientists believed at that point that heavier than air flying machines are impossible. That was the society belief. People thought that anything heavier than air cannot fly. But in 17th December 1903, a special incident happened. What? Yeah, Wright brothers invented or they flew the first aircraft or first air flying object. Now, this was a dream coming into truth. So all the science started like this and later on it matured into a true science. Now, you all are dreaming to be a scientist, am I correct? No? All of you want to be a scientist? Yes? So, as a scientist, it is the most important thing that... What is the most important thing? You have to first dream of something. So, Wright brothers, they had the dream of making this. That's how it started. That's how the science matured. Now, if you take nanotechnology, it is also a dream right now. So it will mature in another 10-20 years later. Still, it's not mature. People are still working on this science. So it may take a while. So it is your job to imagine, to dream about bringing this science into a very special incident like discovery of this aircraft or the space shuttle. So have you seen these pictures or these advertisements on your way?
No.
Huh? Have you ever thought what they mean? Have you seen this? Have you ever used this bulb? Did you think what they are? I just ignored. Have you seen this? Yes. So how many of you thought what they are? Huh?
Small.
Why is single fridge or refrigerator contains nano silver? Why? Or else why the nano bulb? What does it do? Well, if you go to a supermarket, you can buy these bulbs. So this is nano car, but it's not nano, right? It's not really nanotechnology. It is just the name nano, because it is very, very small. Now, let's see what is there in the latter part of my speech. So before that, have you ever experienced this?
Yes.
At the doctor? Yes, everyone. So all of us are scared of the doctors because of this needle punch or injections. So, can anyone tell me why these injections are painful?
Hmm?
Why are they painful? Is it because they are sharp?
They pierce through living cells, your tissues, so that's why you feel pain.
Okay, when it pierces through the living cells, what happens? It passes through the ends of your skin where there are special sense cells, which are known as Valet points. We call them, the red ones are Valet point. They are the ends of this your sense cells, sensing cells. Okay. So when a needle passes through your skin, what happens? Many of your Valet points are injured, or they break many of these points and pierce. Then what happens? Then you get a pain. Now if I say, if you go to the supermarket in Europe and ask for a painless injection, now you can buy. So you anymore, in the future, you don't have to take any pains when you are getting an injection. Why is that? Scientists have come up with new injection arrays, or where what they should do to make it painless. Now when the needle passes through the Valet points only, it damages many of your Valet points. But if you can minimize this damage, you can minimize the pain. That's why bigger the needle, higher the pain. Okay? But What have scientists done now? This needle, they have brought it smaller and smaller so that it damages the minimum number of Valet points on your skin. Therefore, you won't feel the pain once you get this injection. This comes as a plaster which you have to paste onto the skin so that you won't feel. So, this little needle arrays, one is not sufficient, therefore in a plaster there are many needles. So you can get an injection without any pain in the future. So what is this new technology? Let's see. Have you seen this?
Yes.
Huh? This was a very big fashion. What is it? Tattoo. Your parents will not allow you to get any tattoos onto the skin, aren't they? But do you know that they will have a medicinal value very soon? Now the doctor, this is in the clinical trial stage, to come up with the tattoo. The tattoo technique to cure certain or to treat certain diseases. Now for example, if you take diabetic, it's a very common disease right now. There are many diabetic patients, isn't it? So, what do they have to do? They have to check their blood very often, right? They have to see their sugar levels very often. So this is not an easy thing. You don't know when your blood sugar levels will increase or decrease. But with this tattoo technique, you can come up with a method of treating diabetes or diagnosing diabetes. So what to do? Small tattoo is pierced onto your skin. So this tattoo has a color, right? Color with some medication for the disease. Now this tattoo will monitor your blood glucose level 24 hours. In any change, when your blood glucose levels change, this will change the color. So you can see a color change in your tattoo when there is a change in your blood glucose levels. At that point, it will start injecting the necessary medication into your blood stream so that your blood glucose levels is regulated back. And it will come to the previous color and settle down. So any diabetic patient can diagnose the blood glucose level without piercing the finger very often with this technique. Coming back to another one. This is the technique practicing. So you all know. You all know. Heart attacks are also a common disease right now. You can see heart patients very often. Maybe you have heard, okay, certain person died by a silent heart attack. So, what's the risk in heart attack? You don't know when your heart rate or heartbeat changes. You won't know it prior, or you don't diagnose it early if you don't take any ECG. So you know how to take an ECG. You have to go to a lab and fix 6 electrodes onto your body, a big machine like that, and then the machine will detect your heartbeat. But this is not an easy exercise. You can't do this very often. Do you know, now there are ECG patches, something called wearable ECG patch, which you can wear. You can wear this patch, and this patch will monitor your heart rate 24 hours. Okay? So this heart rate monitoring will happen when you sleep, when you walk, when you do exercise, and under any circumstances, it will monitor your heartbeat. And in case of any changes in your heartbeat, it will send you a message into the mobile phone. This is connected to your mobile, and the mobile phone will get a message saying, okay, you have a change in your heartbeat. This mobile phone is connected remotely to a doctor. So this is, there is a Bluetooth connection, and this is connected to a doctor out there. So there will be a centralized location where patient has to register, and then this message will go to the doctor out there. So then he can attend to your problem immediately, because he will get your ECG pattern with the message. So this is known as remote health monitoring. So even in Sri Lanka, we did a patch like this, heart monitoring sensor, or wearable heart monitoring sensor, ECG sensor, and Dialog is looking for the opportunity of that, you know, the Dialog company, commercializing it, or at least using it in hospitals initially. So this is some new technology. This sensor is made by this new technology. So you need something small to do the task. So this is one application. Now, medical sector, although there are many applications, I will not talk in detail, but now let me move on to the textiles. So your pair of socks, are you going to wear it tomorrow?
No.
No? Why?
Huh? It has dirt.
It has dirt and?
Sweat.
It is smelly. Due to sweat, it is smelly. But do you know, when your sweat comes out of the body, it is an odorless liquid. There is no smell. So once it comes to the surface of your skin, it gets the bacteria attack, and then it becomes, it gets a bad odor. That's why your sweat has a bad smell. But if I say, in the future, very soon, now also available, you don't have to wash your clothes anymore. You can wear your cloth without washing. No? Yes. Why do we have to wash? Because it is smelly and there are dirt. If I make a textile, if I make your shirt, which prevents the bacterial attack on your sweat, and which does not allow the dirt to come and stick, you are with the shirt that need not wash. Not agreed?
Not forever.
Until the action is there with your clothes. You can't buy shirts for your lifetime. So it will be maybe a few months, the manufacturer will recommend you what is the time duration. But this type of textiles are available. Can you tell me an example of the nature where there is a very clean surface? Dirt does not come and fit onto it, and water is not getting absorbed.
It won't have lots of pores to be.
Yeah, well, from nature example, I'm asking an example.
Lotus
leaf. We call it lotus effect. Now there are lotus effect clothes available in the In the water, if I show you,
have you put water?
No.
Can you put a drop?
So the coating has little been damaged in this textile because of handling by many students. But hope still it's there. So can you see? So this textile has the lotus leaf effect, so that the water drops does not stick onto it. It will, now in the morning you can take your shirt, put in a bucket of water and wear it, because all the dirt will be removed, anything unnecessary can be removed, you can pass it.
Sorry?
It won't get wet. It has the lotus effect. Right? So there, this has been manufactured by looking at the nature's creation. So looking at the lotus leaf, it has been converted to a commercial product like that. So this kind of textiles, which you don't, your socks pair, you can buy in the market. You don't have to wash. So, and also, now today you came for this seminar. Does your mother know where you are? Any missing colleagues?
No.
Maybe they came from home saying coming to the seminar, but they never attended. But in the future you can't do this because sensors have been developed where the sensor can be attached to your shirt. Your mother can monitor from home what happens to you. Right? So this kind of sensors will be available very soon. Now this may be a bad news for you, but there is a sector who needs it. If you take the security forces, the forces, when the soldiers are in war, the central location, central people don't know what happened to them. So if it is attached to the soldiers, they can monitor from one location what happened to the soldiers in the war. Or else think of a very big farm. Farmer can put one sensor to each cow or the cattle and send them out, and he can see what happened to his cattle. The future farming will be remote farming like this. So this kind of sensors will be soon available. And this may be a good news. Now you are wearing one colored shirt today. Now you think, okay, I don't like this shirt, I want to change the color. With a little change, with maybe a button press, maybe some changes in the environment, can change the color of your cloth.
That's making us more lazy.
Maybe you have to think of the technology, this is the technology coming up. So you can change the, these are known as color changing fabrics. So you can change the color. So such. So this was a recent application of this new technology. So this is a wedding dress. Okay? This dress has been made without putting any stitches. Oh, it has not been sewn. Right? How have they made it? Let me show you. It is not a tailor-made or stitch garment. So it has been sprayed onto your body. In the future, maybe Odell, No Limit will be, there won't be any more clothes like you find today. See the technology. So these small fibers have been dissolved in a solvent which is harmless to your body, and they are known as spray on textile. You just spray it as you wish. So if you don't like the, if you like the shirt, you can wash it and use. If you don't like, you can pre-spray the material. So you can have any colors, any pattern that you like on your textile. done. So, today it is not available in the market, but this has been used in certain medical applications. Think of a bone fracture. So, when there is a bone fracture right now, you have to get a very big plaster of Paris bandage. So, these are very clumsy. But this technique can be used in bone fracture treatments. Just spray you can also add the medication into the spray and put a little bandage on the bone fracture.
Nanometer.
1 billionth of a meter is 1 nanometer. Can you imagine how small is nano? How small is 1 nanometer? So let me tell you these examples. Take out one of your hair and see the diameter. If you take one hair out and see the diameter, there are 80,000 nanometers across your hair. This is how this hair is seen under a very special microscope, which is known as the scanning electron microscope. So the diameter here is 80,000 nanometers. So in nanometers, your hair diameter is 80,000. Or else, if I do this, and if I do this, within this time period, your hair grows by 1 nanometer. Can you see how small it is? Huh? So it is a very, very small thing. Or else, if I ask you to tell your height in nanometers, your height will be billions of nanometers. Okay? So nanometer is something very, very small. But when you talk about nanotechnology, we don't take the complete nanoscale for nanotechnology applications. We specifically select 1 to 100 nanometer particles. If something is 1 to 100 nanometer size scale, and if you use that particle to create some new product, we call it is nanotechnology. So nanoscience is understanding the properties of the particles of 1 to 100 nanometers. And if you apply these particles to a product, we call it is the nanotechnology. Right? So remember the number 1 to 100 nanometer, not below 1 or not beyond 100, to a very special reason which I can't explain it now. So properties at nano level drastically change. So you see, now we are in the macro world. In the macro world, you see certain properties for the materials. These properties change significantly when they get into the nano world. Or if you make a particle below 100 nanometers, the properties will be very different from its bulk material. Okay? So, let me take some examples for this. You know gold. You know gold? What color is it?
Gold.
Gold color. It has a nice yellow color. Right? It is inert. What are the properties of gold? Nice yellow color. Conducts electricity, inert, shiny, it can be made into a wire, you can change the shape. But if you take maybe your teacher's bangle, and if I break into two, it is still, you can try this, it is still a gold, it is still a gold bangle. But if I make these particles, if I make this bangle, two particles which has a size of 100 nanometer, the color will be something like this. Slightly below 100 nanometer, I can change the color, but this is slightly red. If you hold this against a white background, you can see it is slightly red. So I can change the color. This is gold particles which I have taken into a solution. This is in the solution phase. So I can make series of colors by changing the particle size. You can make gold into those colors. Below 100 nanometer, if you change the size of the particles, you can make different colors for gold. Similarly for silver, this is a silver solution. This also, please hold on behind the white paper, you can see slight purple color. This is nano silver. So you can change the color. Materials change the color when you make nano compounds or nano materials out of these bulk materials. So your gold or silver will no longer be inert. It will be very reactive at this stage. That's why I have put it in a solution phase and I have prevented the particle agglomeration by putting into a solution. So you can see this is how they look like under a very special scanning electron microscope. So these are some special properties. In other words, materials change their optical properties when you make nanoparticles. So this is some pictures taken from old cathedrals in Europe. So there are these beautiful stained glass decorations in these cathedrals. It has been found these stained glass, the colors are not due to any pigment, because any pigment will change the color with time. So these colors have not been changed. Therefore, it has been found that these are made of nano silver and nano gold. Maybe knowingly or unknowingly, these stained glasses are made from nano silver and nano gold. So, do you think nano is new? This new technology is something new? No. It has been there with our nature from the date of creation of this world. It is not something new. It is not something new. Right? So the nature knew. Nature created many things using this small technology. Now, if you take the processes happening in our body, right? If you take our, for example, take your brain. So brain, the cells are not nano, but the functions happening inside the cell are happening in a nano factory. Otherwise, your brain cannot perform this much of activities simultaneously. For example, it can see, it can hear, all this sensing goes to your brain. It can recognize everything separately. But remember, anything on the brain cell is not nano, but inside the cell, the activities are happening at a nano level. So this is very special that nature knew this technology before the, even at the creation. Everything on your body, think of your body. So it has been created in such a way that each of your part of the body knows what functions it has to perform. The hands functions are not done by the legs function. All these details are given in your DNA or in your cell. It has been written by the start. So this is a very special creation of the nature. And also, think of this big tree. So this has started with this little seed. Now, all the information needed for this tree to grow is embedded in this little seed. All the engineering diagrams are drawn. How? You can't draw big diagrams. But the nature has taught this cell or this seed what to do and how to bring up this tree. It doesn't need any external information for it to grow. So everything happens from that initial teaching or initial engineering diagrams. See how beautifully the nature has created everything. So my advice, one advice to you is, if you want to be a scientist, it is very important you be with the nature, you learn the nature. So nature will have some examples for what you want to create. For every creation, there is a nature's example. So that is very important. For example, if you take these butterflies, how did they get these beautiful wings? It's not a dye, it's not a pigment. It is a nano effect. A very special nano effect on their wings. That's how it got this color. Peacock got its beautiful blue color. How? It is also a special nano effect. If you learn nanotechnology further, you can see what is the reason for this special effect. And also, you know the spider. Did you ever think that this is the most strongest and, this is the strongest and most flexible natural material in the world? It is very strong and it is flexible too. For example, spider can make his net even several meters from one place to the other. Why? This material he generates is very strong. Spider silk. Did you know that spider silk contained nanomaterials? It is due to this nano effect again. So lotus leaf, you just saw a textile with lotus leaf. So this has been there for ages. You have seen this for several years. Did you ever think that this can be converted into a product? Who thought about it? We never do it. Our poets wrote a lot of poems with this, but no scientist investigated then come up with some commercial product. See, nature has given the example. So we think that the lotus leaf is very smooth. When you touch it, it's very smooth. But if I put it into that special microscope and observe, you can see some kind of bumps at the nano level. So nano level bumps are there with this lotus leaf. So that's why the water does not stick into the surface. That's why water makes a droplet on the surface. So these are very beautiful creations of gecko. So you have seen geckos on your ceiling? Have you? Did you think that the reason why gecko does not fall with the gravity? We can't stick onto a wall, but the gecko can. Why? No gravitational force? No gravity? Gravity does not pull it out? Yes, gravity is there. But what is this specialty? If you take the hand of the gecko and put it into that microscope, very special microscope which I showed you at the beginning, the gecko feet will look like this. So there are very tiny hairs on the gecko feet. These hairs are very tiny. And there are millions of hairs on his feet. When it stick onto the surface, this little hair make a small force with the ceiling. So since there are millions of hair on its feet, the resultant force or the total force upward is higher than the gravitational force. Then it cannot fall. But try and see when there is a gecko upside down, just put some water onto the ceiling, it will fall. Because it cannot make this special force when the surface is wet. It can make it only with the dry surface. But there are certain sea creatures which can make this force even with the wet surfaces. Now, gecko feet, that technique is converted into Spider-Man gloves today. There are gloves similar to Spider-Man glove, which has this gecko feet effect. So this gecko feet effect is converted into introduced onto a glove surface. Then when you touch into the ceiling, you will not fall. So this is a very special technique. Now, you must be thinking, what materials can do all these wonders? Now I told several applications. Everything, you need some new material. So for the 21st century, scientists have identified some important materials which can do these wonders. So one is carbon. Carbon-based nanomaterials are the most important nanomaterial for this century. So when you talk about carbon, you know nature's favorite element is also carbon. It used carbon for many creations. If you look at the periodic table, which is the nature's gift for you to do any wonders in this world. You can do anything by looking at the periodic table basically. Any creation can be done. So, how can you do it? Now, nature has used carbon because it has wonders. You can do wonderful things with carbon. But how carbon do this, all these wonders? Your pencil has carbon. Is it strong enough to do some wonderful job? And on the other hand, we have diamond, which is not flexible, you can't change the shape, it has some other special properties. So both these materials can meet a level compound. And then finally, they wanted to give a name to this special finding, this special carbon. How did they find the name? One day they went to this special geodome. So this is like a stadium, we call it a geodome. So they went into this dome. When they entered the dome, when they saw the structure, they felt that this has a very similar, this is 60 carbons can be aligned into this shape. And they came and aligned. Yes, they got that shape. Shape of a football. And they wanted to give the name there. Well, how did they find the name? Anyone know?
By the person who made it.
Yes. Geodome was designed by somebody called Buckminster Fuller. So they call it either Buckyball or Fullery. So that's how the name came to this special carbon shape. So with this carbon introduction, people started working on other carbon structures as well. The very first thing came out of this curiosity was a special form of carbon which is the shape of a tube. Can I have this for a minute? So if you take a plain paper like this and roll it, this is a tube. So if you take one carbon sheet and roll it, you end up with a carbon nanotube. We call it a carbon nanotube. Where to get this sheet? From graphite. Graphite has a structure like your pages of the book. So what do you have to do? Peel one page and roll it. Peel one page and roll it. Even if you peel one page and use it for industrial purpose, this has nano level properties. You can use it for many applications. This one page. So this is the trick. So carbon nanotube is currently a magic compound. So you know it is the strongest material ever found. At the nano level, carbon significantly changed the properties. Carbon nanotube is 10 times stronger than steel. And it is flexible. So your computers in the future will be made of the hard disk. Hard drive will be coming out of these carbon nanotubes because the capacity will be very high because these are at the nano level compounds. So CNT was the most important compound and it is derived from graphite. So when you talk about graphite and these other forms of graphite, which is like the page of your book, we call it graphene. And these carbon nanotubes, we can't forget these two people. Who are they? Can you tell me the name of this people? Who are they? 2010, who won the Nobel Prize for Physics? Who won the Nobel Prize for Physics in 2010? Guillemin Navier's law. One person is very young, about 36 years old. The other one is about 50 years old. So, how did they win the Nobel Prize? Very simple thing. Don't think to win the Nobel Prize, you have to do rocket science. What was the experiment? They were in a lab working with graphite. graphite is the thing in your pencil. Right? So, see the first picture, not the second, first one. So, what did they do? Now, they were doing some serious experiments with graphite. Now, his boss or the supervisor is doing serious experiments with carbon. These two were crazy scientists. Crazy people. They didn't want to listen to their boss. Their hobby was, on the carbon, they paste a sellotape or scotch tape, we call, and peel it off. So that's how you clean the carbon surface when you do experiments. Just paste a scotch tape and peel it off. And put it in scotch tape into the bin and you use the carbon for the experiment. So they were doing this all time. That was their hobby. Paste it and peel it and put in the bin. So one Friday afternoon, when they wanted to empty the bin, they saw a special thing in this scotch tape. Now you know carbon is black color, but scotch tape was not black, transparent. They thought some special thing would have happened. So they put this scotch tape under the microscope and saw, and then they realized that they have peeled off one sheet of graphite. Now graphite is several sheets. So peeling off one sheet is very difficult. So if you peel off one sheet, it has very special properties. So they have done it. Scotch tape, they have peeled off one graphite sheet. So that was their Nobel Prize. That was their Nobel Prize. They needed only a piece of carbon and a scotch tape for the Nobel Prize. So it's up to you to think of some crazy ideas and do some special things. So this frog pie I put, in the same year they got some other Nobel Prize which is known as the Ig Nobel Prize. For what? They did this, again a crazy experiment. On a magnet, this is not nano, on a magnet they float a frog. They were able to float a frog like this. So this was the foundation for this magnetic trains, you know, superconducting trains, so which can go without touching the magnet. So this was the early foundation. So these were some, see, but you have lot of things that you can do. Now, we are talking about graphite and carbon nanotubes. You know the price? 1 gram of carbon nanotube in good quality would be about $250 for 1 gram. Can you use it for any practical applications? Very difficult because it's a small amount, is very expensive. But do you know this is a carbon nanotube factory in Iran? They make about 8 kilograms a day. And this type of operation, when you come to nanomaterials, you don't need to make metric tons. You just need to make in gram or kilogram quantities. What do you think? In your garage, can't you make this carbon nanotube? Did you know Sri Lanka is the country which exports the best quality graphite into the world market? The best quality graphite goes from Sri Lanka, Kahatagaha and Gogala. You know the price? We sell 1 kilogram at 90 rupees. Right? So, see about the profit that you can generate if you can introduce some value addition to these materials. The second most important material for the... Oh, before that, I just wanted to show this Damocles sword. So this, you know, at this period, Sri Lanka and India were the countries that sent the most powerful swords to the world market. Right? So why this power? There is an imagination or there is a concept, belief that these swords were made of nano carbon. You know, iron and carbon has to be mixed together to make steel. So this carbon is nano. That's why this has this special strength. Has it been proven, doctor?
I'm not sure about the narrow connection, but it is.
But there is
Damascus,
a hypothesis,
Damascus steel was made here.
Yes. So, we have to explore and see whether it's correct or not. Now, moving on to the next important material for the 21st century is titanium dioxide. Your paint and maybe future solar cells needs titanium dioxide. So, do we have titanium dioxide in Sri Lanka? Yes. If you go to the eastern coast, there is titanium dioxide. Black sand contains 60% titanium dioxide. That's one of the richest titanium ores in the world. So what do? We take a backhoe, go there, take the sand and export it. So we export usually 80,000 metric tons a year. 80,000 metric tons at a cost of 100 rupees per kilogram. We earn US dollars 8 million by sending this 80,000 metric tons of our beach sand. But we import parallelly 5,000 metric tons only for paint industry. For the paint industry only, we spend $12.5 million. So what do you think? And nano titanium dioxide is going to be one of the wonderful materials in our next applications. Can't we do some value addition to our own mineral? So these are some questions I leave up to you. You might be thinking, do we have facilities to do all this? Yes, we do have. We do have all the facilities required to do nanotechnology based research. We can come up with new things with this research. So, where we can do? So, Sri Lanka introduced nanotechnology to Sri Lanka in 2005, I would say. The first cabinet paper went out in 2005 and there was a cabinet approval to establish a nanotechnology park in Sri Lanka. As a result, 60 acres of land was allocated at home government to come up with the nanotechnology park and a research center. Since the park was a long-term goal, government decided we have to come up with some short-term research laboratory. As a result, Sri Lanka Institute of Nanotechnology was established in 2009 to do all nanotechnology based research. So the difference in this research institute is it does not belong to the government totally. When the establishment discussions were going on, government understood that this job cannot be done alone. It needs lot of money. So what the government did, they invited the private sector companies to join in hand with the government to start this lab. So five private sector companies, Brandix, you know, one giant in textile, Dialux, to whom we made the sensor, and Halis, and Lordstar, and Mars Holdings. Five companies joined the government to come up with this new lab. In 2009, the lab was established with totally Sri Lankan skills. All Sri Lankans were working in this lab. Now, in 2009, all these five companies joining with the government and allocating funds, there was a big resistance from the society. Why do you spend so much on nanotechnology? Because it was just after the war. Just after the war, why are you going to spend this much of money on nanotechnology? There was a big resistance. So even it was really difficult to start this company. I was there from the beginning at the company, and let me explain some few wins that we have come up to today. Few wins. So one of the projects came from Halis. Halis Agriculture was to come up with the new fertilizer. Come up with a new slow-release fertilizer formulation. You know, plants need nutrients. Like you need nutrients, plant need nutrients in excess. So three major nutrients they need is nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Right? Nitrogen is usually supplied as urea. When you give urea into a plant, usually about 50 to 80% is washed off. Plant cannot absorb. 50 to 80% is just washed off. This is the amount of money that Sri Lanka has spent bringing fertilizer or urea into the country. For example, 528,000 metric tons of urea was imported in 2011, out of which, if you see the loss of urea into the environment, we lose $308 million. $308 million is lost without using. Think of just 10% saving. Think of just 10%, we save $44 million per year. So this was the challenge. Kelly's agriculture wanted to make us a new urea fertilizer based on nanotechnology. At this point, it was really a big challenge. We had to think about the cost factors. You can't make very costly fertilizer because farmers are the people who use it. It's for poor. So we have to come up with some simple solution as well. So what was our solution? Urea, when it is alone, when you put into water, it dissolves quickly. What we did, take a nanoparticle and bind this urea into the nanoparticle. So when you are alone, you can run fast. But if I am holding you, you can't run fast. So that was the technique. Now we need a nanoparticle to hold this urea. What is the nanoparticle we put? It is the most environmentally friendly nanoparticle in your bone. It is the particle in your bone which is known as hydroxyapatite. Epavalapatite, hydroxyapatite, you may have heard. Convert it into a nanoparticle, then you have a big surface area. So you can bind lot of urea into this surface now. So with a small amount of hydroxyapatite nanoparticle, you can bind lot of urea into this. So this is the fertilizer that we have made. This is slow release, or this doesn't dissolve very easily. So like for paddy, we can just 50% of the current application is sufficient, and one time application is again enough. You don't have to do multiple applications. So this is the fertilizer that we have made. Once we did this new fertilizer system, our next question was what to do next. This is how it looked like under the microscope. If you put this into that special microscope and observe it, this is how it looked like. One particle is about 15 nanometers in diameter. Very small particles. And usually when you come up with a new innovation or new finding, then you can publish your data or you can go and fill a patent in the patent office. What is meant by a patent? It is the ownership. And to get a patent, what is the criteria? You should be the world first to do that. You should be the first to do that, otherwise you won't get a patent. So we applied the patent in the US patent office. Very expensive to apply a patent in the US patent office. Especially, we applied two patents. You can see the two patents. And after applying, what to do next? Kelly's Agro was the industrial partner, but they didn't want to take the innovation forward. They were reluctant. Investment was very high to start a fertilizer factory. So we were wondering here and there, thinking there was a lot of blame coming up. You spent this much, what are you going to do next? We had no way out at that time. As scientists, we went and wrote a paper and published it in a journal. So we just wrote a paper and published it in a journal. So at this point, a very special thing happened. What was it? One of the leading fertilizer company in India grabbed this paper. And they started calling us, can you give us your technology? We are ready to commercially make this. At this point, any of the higher level managers didn't want to do, including the minister. They said, no, Indians are not reliable. We can't give it. But after 6 months of very serious negotiation, the Sri Lankan government and the Slintech management agreed to sell this patent or the technology to an Indian company for a $3.1 million. So this was the signing of the agreements for technology transfer. So we were lucky to have them as our partners after that, because Sri Lanka got some money out of this. Was a sale. This was one of the first sales in technology in the recent past. And also, we have made a pilot plant for making this fertilizer now. And we were fortunate to be the very first people to get a nanotechnology-based patent to Sri Lanka. So this was the very first nanotechnology-based patent from US Patent Office. We have now 3 patents out of the same innovation. So this is the proposed nanotechnology park where you can work in the future. This is at Tomagama. You are welcome to come and see this. The one part of this structure has been completed. We are there now. This is the lab where we do all this research. So you can come and see the lab if you like. Just make a request to us. So this is Sri Lanka Institute of Nanotechnology. And before that, before I wind up my talk, let me give a small advice to you. You all want to be good scientists in the future. You must be wondering, how am I going to be a world-class researcher? Because you have to be a world-class researcher to get some recognition for your finding. How can you be a world-class researcher? Psychologists say, if you spend 10,000 hours on one of the tasks or one activity, 10,000 hours, you can be world class. All these people have spent 10,000 hours on their achievement. So what is 10,000? 2.7 hours a day, 10 years. If you work 2.7 hours a day for 10 years, you can be world class. So in the evening, without standing in front of the television, watching other people crying, please do some important thing. 2.7 hours times 10, you will get to a world-class scientist. And before wind up, remember this word, serendipity. What is serendipity? So unexpected discovery. On your way, there will be a lot of unexpected discoveries. Be mindful of these discoveries. So I will stop here.